welcome to the Chapel of St John's College, Durham, for our service of evening worship. This is a place of worship that has been used for over 900 years, and it's wonderful that we can join together wherever you are gathering from Durham, from elsewhere in the UK or overseas. As I came up the Bailey this evening, I saw the beech tree, that wonderful beech tree outside the chapel that we love so much, coming into full leaf. It was a wonderful sign of hope that many of us are feeling at the beginning of this term. And certainly it's wonderful within this chapel that it's once again being used for daily worship and prayer. And you are so welcome at this weekly service of college worship for the whole of St John's College. My name is Philip Plyming. I serve as Warden of Cranmer Hall within St John's College, and I'll be leading us in our service with Shaquille and Emma in the band. And it's a particular pleasure to have Canon Anna Brooker, our college chaplain, who will be continuing our sermon series on blessings, looking at the wonderful promises of Jesus in the Beatitudes. And tonight we'll be exploring the blessing, the Beatitude, blessed are the poor in spirit. And we're looking forward to all that Anna is going to share with us later. Now, my experience of joining YouTube worship is, to put it slightly simply, the more you put in, the more you get out. There's something about being attentive, there's something about being present, there's something about just being focused, albeit on a screen, but through that screen with other people in worship together. So can I encourage you, perhaps if you haven't, to say hello using the chat function from wherever you are joining us this evening. Perhaps to light a candle, as I sometimes do, just to remind that this is a special time when we are coming consciously into God's presence with others. And perhaps to stand up as you sing and not worry about the noise that you're making, but just to kind of bring our bodies into worship as well. Whatever way it is that you find yourself being present, I hope and pray that as we gather together, that you will meet with the Lord and the Lord will meet with you. So with that in mind, let us pray. Faithful one, whose word is life, come with saving power to free our praise, inspire our prayer, and shape our lives for the kingdom of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. All you need to for our service this evening is on the order of service that was emailed out earlier today, or is also available on the link on the YouTube page. And in our opening song, we're invited to inhabit fully the Easter season that is still our celebration and our joy at this time. This song invites us to go on a journey from Good Friday through to Easter Sunday and to celebrate the Easter faith that is ours. I cast my mind to Calvary.
Praise his name.
And so as we remain in that season of praise of Easter, let's use this opening prayer of thanksgiving to praise the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Alleluia! Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia! Praise the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. He has given us new life and hope. He has raised Jesus from the dead. God has claimed us as his own. He has brought us out of darkness. He has made us light to the world. Alleluia, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. And so we come to our risen Christ as Catherine Thubronner, Ordinand at Cranmer Hall, leads us in our prayers of intercession.
For the response when I say, blessed are the poor in spirit, please respond with, for theirs is the kingdom of God. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God. Lord, as we pray for your broken world, we ask that you reveal your justice, blessings, and provision to those poor in spirit. Let us recognize our own spiritual poverty and be dedicated to a reordering of your creation. Help us to become true life-giving followers of Jesus and a witness for justice in the world. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God. Lord, we pray for those who mourn. We think especially for those families in India who have lost loved ones to COVID, as we pray for swift action to help those who are still seriously ill and who lack vital medicines. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God. We pray for those who have died in Mexico City in a metro train crash, killing at least 23, including children. And we pray with their families and friends who are deep in mourning and in need of your presence and tender care. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God. Lord, as we think of those closer to home, we pray for the county of Durham. We pray for those who we see on our streets that need a home, those who are drug dependent, or those who simply struggle to live within society. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God. Lord, we give thanks and ask for blessings upon those who give silently and often unnoticed around us. And we pray and give thanks for those who commit humbly to a life of prayer. We pray for those who mourn the past. We pray you would inspire hope for the future, where words and needs have been left undone. Help us to accept what we cannot change, and give us strength to change that which we can. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God. Lord our Father, we realise that our lives are handed over to the mystery we call God, not in an abstract way, but here and now. We ask that you show us how great is your call to let go of our selfishness, turn wholly to you, and to serve others. We humbly ask that the blessings promised to the poor in spirit lead us to the treasures of your kingdom through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
And the collect for today. Almighty God, who through your only begotten Son Jesus Christ have overcome death and opened to us the gate of everlasting life, grant that, as by your grace going before us, you put into our minds good desires, so by your continual help, we may bring them to good effect through Jesus Christ, our risen Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
And we continue our prayers with the Lord's Prayer in the language of our hearts. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us not our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you.
In a moment, Richard Grant, Ordinand at Cranmer Hall, will read us our reading from Matthew's Gospel. Before that, Benji Etheridge, an undergraduate at John's Hall, will read the first 9 verses of Isaiah 61.
The first reading is taken from the book of Isaiah, chapter 61, verses 1 to 9. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me. He has sent me to bring good news to the oppressed, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and release to the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favour and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to provide for those who mourn in Zion, to give them a garland instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the mantle of praise instead of a faint spirit. They will be called oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, to display his glory. They shall build up the ancient ruins. They shall raise up the former devastations. They shall repair the ruined cities, the devastations of many generations. Strangers shall stand and feed your flocks. Foreigners shall till your land and dress your vines. But you shall be called priests of the Lord. You shall be named ministers of our God. You shall enjoy the wealth of the nations, and in their riches you shall glory. Because their shame was double, and dishonour was proclaimed as their lot, therefore they shall possess a double portion. Everlasting joy shall be theirs. For I, the Lord, love justice. I hate robbery and wrongdoing. I will faithfully give them their recompense, and I will make an everlasting covenant with them. Their descendants shall be known amongst the nations, and their offspring among the peoples. All who see them shall acknowledge that they are a people whom the Lord has blessed. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Our second reading is from Matthew 23, verses 1 to 12. Then Jesus said to the crowds and to his disciples, "The scribes and the Pharisees sit on Moses' seat. Therefore, do whatever they teach you and follow it. But do not do as they do, for they do not practice what they teach. They tie up heavy burdens, hard to bear, and lay them on the shoulders of others. But they themselves are unwilling to lift a finger to move them. They do all their deeds to be seen by others, for they make their phylacteries broad and their fringes long. They love to have the place of honour at banquets and the best seats in the synagogues, and to be greeted with respect in the marketplaces, and to have people call them rabbi. But you are not to be called rabbi, for you have one teacher, and you are all students. And call no one your father on earth, for you have one father, the one in heaven. Nor are you to be called instructors, for you have one instructor, the Messiah. The greatest among you will be your servant. All who exalt themselves will be humbled, and all who humble themselves will be exalted." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks
be to God.
Before Anna comes to preach for us, let's use the words of our next song to offer a prayer to God that we will both hear and receive God's word to us, that it will take root in us, and that we will produce fruit through not only hearing, but obeying. Speak, O Lord, as we come to you.
Speak, O Lord, as we come to you.
Let us pray. Holy Spirit, come now and inspire my words, open our hearts to hear you, and set us free to live for you, for Jesus' sake. Amen.
Amen.
Our good friend Miro, resident tutor at John's, has been setting and judging the college MasterChef competition every week this year, with commendable creativity and even-handedness. But last week, his judgment faltered. Not because of the result, but because of the theme he chose. Spring is here. Thinking perhaps that in a week that saw the start of May, we could happily turn to lighter dishes for warmer days. Unfortunately, Miro didn't consult the weather forecast. So, struggling with thoughts of salad, I found myself longing for a good old-fashioned pudding. Jam roly-poly, perhaps, or treacle sponge, or even that 70s classic pineapple upside-down cake. Straight from the oven, I can tell that Philip really likes that one. Now, this is one of those miracles of baking where you lay a foundation of succulent fruit rings, sprinkle them liberally with brown sugar, and then cover them over with a very insipid-looking cake mix. So they're entirely hidden. Emerging from the oven, however, the cake has integrated fully and the pineapple rings have soaked in syrup and they're ensconced in golden sponge, so that when you turn it out of the tin, they reappear in all their glory. Well, in case you're wondering where I'm going with this, there is a spiritual point. Tonight we're considering not so much upside-down puddings as upside-down theology. As the poet Malcolm Guite put it, Matthew is the gospel of the great reversal. In God's kingdom, things turn out God's way, not ours. It may look as if the confident and competent hold all the power, but God lifts up the humble. It may look as if the rich hold all the cards, but God sees and saves the poor. An upside-down kingdom, indeed. Welcome back to the Beatitudes, God's blessings as announced by Jesus. After last week's introduction, we home in tonight on the first of the nine. We'll consider how the two Bible readings we've just heard from Isaiah and from the latter part of Matthew illuminate the first beatitude. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. These words headline the whole list and set the scene for the eight that follow, proclaiming blessing not just in the shape of one quality or gift, but the kingdom of heaven itself to those who are poor in spirit. And as we turn back to Isaiah in our first reading, we can see more clearly who the poor in spirit may be. God's messenger in Isaiah, who turns out to be Jesus, is sent to bring good news to the oppressed and to bind up the brokenhearted. And in those two descriptions, the oppressed and the brokenhearted, I think we have two helpful ways in to seeing who is poor in spirit. The oppressed, those who have little power or agency in their lives through lack of education, skills, opportunity, or resources, through negative treatment or experience. Oppressed perhaps because of their age, gender, sexuality, or race, but infinitely precious, significant, and loved by God. There was a historic piece of good news to the oppressed last month in the conviction of former US police officer Derek Chauvin for the murder of George Floyd. And an everyday American in a podcast described it like this: "What happened was wrong, and I'm so glad we got it right this time. Tonight," that's the night the verdict was announced, "we took the first in some steps to get to a place we need to be. In that act of justice, which overturned accepted norms and those precedents that colluded in them, the kingdom of heaven came a step closer, not just for George Floyd's family and community, but for all who identify with them, who long for change now and in the future. God blesses the poor in spirit who are oppressed." "The Lord has sent me," continues Isaiah's messenger, "to bind up the brokenhearted." Binding up, it's such a tender and personal action, as well as being practical and life-saving. The Good Samaritan bound up the wounds of the man who'd been mugged, his supposed enemy. It's a gentle, careful action, not to be rushed, focused where the wound is deepest or the break sharpest. And this binding is of the broken heart. The wounds tended are those caused by disappointment, by loss, by despair. And the breaks bound are caused by ruptures in security or relationship. All those who are brokenhearted in this way know themselves to be poor in spirit, to have little left of themselves to draw on, scant resources of hope, of courage, of joy. But God blesses the poor in spirit who are brokenhearted. I read about Florence, who features in the backstory to this year's Christian Aid Week, which takes place next week. She lives in Kenya. She works as a farmer and a beekeeper to keep her family. She was brokenhearted, widowed, almost destitute, having seen the lush farmlands of her childhood disappear in the face of extreme weather and climate change. She describes the everyday miracle brought about by the building of an earth dam through Christian Aid's local partner. This conserves water and saves her and many others a six-hour walk to their previous water source. Truly a blessing for all. And Florence says it's more than just the dam. That in her weakness she cried out to God for strength, and in her despair she opened her life to God's promise of hope for the future. She recognises God's blessing, and she rejoices now, singing as she tends the community garden where her vegetables grow, laughing with friends at the market where she sells her honey. God blesses the poor in spirit who are broken-hearted. I'm challenged and humbled by both these stories of God's blessing for the oppressed and the broken-hearted who are poor in spirit. I know I am too often self-sufficient, self-absorbed, or self-righteous. Far from being poor in spirit, I pretend I'm fine, I can cope. And I become closed off to God and myself and others. I long to see life more through the Holy Spirit's lens. Not so I become mired in guilt, but so I am released to see God's amazing blessings and how our expectations are turned upside down through God's grace and power. Isaiah 61 is a prophetic vision of the kingdom of heaven, where God's values and priorities hold sway, and where the world's values, based all too often on selfishness and greed, are upended, so that people are blessed in many of the same ways that we see in the Beatitudes. And that prophecy of Isaiah that we heard prefigures Jesus' birth and ministry. There are echoes of it from Mary in her song of praise when she learns that she's going to be Jesus' mother. And later on in Luke's gospel, those verses are the very same scripture which Jesus reads in the synagogue in Nazareth at the outset of his public ministry, when he tells listeners that the words are being fulfilled among them right here and now. In many ways, that scene in Luke is the parallel of the Beatitudes in Matthew. Both of them, at the very start of Jesus' ministry and teaching, proclaim good news, blessings from God. For, as Richard Briggs emphasised last week quite a few times, the blessing comes first. The arrival of the kingdom, the year of the Lord's favour, which Isaiah foretold, is here and now in the life and teaching of Jesus, here and now in God's upside-down community where the poor receive good news and the humble are exalted. It was true in Nazareth 2,000 and more years ago, and it's true for us today if we can but see it. Last Tuesday, Richard also reminded us that Matthew, in his gospel, shows how Jesus came to fulfill all of the Old Testament, both the law of Moses and the words and warnings of the prophets, especially perhaps Isaiah, whom he quotes most frequently, usually with helpful asides to the reader that goes something like, "This was to fulfill what the prophet had spoken." As Matthew sandwiches blocks of teaching with stories of miracles, the fulfillment of the law and the prophets in Jesus' life becomes more and more evident. The passage we heard from tonight, from Matthew 23, is the start of Matthew's fifth and final sermon teaching of Jesus. Now in Jerusalem and approaching the end of his ministry and life, Jesus gives a stern warning about those who teach the law but don't live it, who don't practice what they preach. His cartoon depictions of scribes and Pharisees are worthy of spitting image. Huge phylacteries, leather boxes with mini scrolls in, attached to foreheads and arms, very prominently, to show off their outward submission to scripture. Or massively long blue cords on their shawls that almost trip them up as they show off their public devotion to prayer. I expect the crowd really enjoyed this bit of stand-up, especially with its local subject matter. They had laboured all their lives under the endless rules and regulations imposed by the religious authorities, and especially in the temple, with its own police force even. Judaism was all too often duty and drudge, with a privileged minority enjoying status and wealth. All this Jesus spotlights as he lambasts those religious teachers. We need to hear that today as well. But then comes this upside down proclamation. The greatest among you will be your servant. For in just a few days, the Son of God will be shown to be Isaiah's suffering servant, fulfilling that prophecy as he submits to betrayal, injustice, humiliation, violence, and death. The greatest will be a humble servant, seemingly dead and buried, but then raised to life and exalted, and Christ's humble obedience, even to the cross, both enables and demonstrates the blessing for all. All who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. God's justice has come and will come. The poor in spirit are and will be blessed. The kingdom of heaven is and will be theirs. It's the upside-down theology of the upside-down kingdom. And it's a different way of being. If we don't live like this, we miss the glorious truth hidden in plain sight. We miss the blessings. It's about seeing the people and things that are overlooked rather than obvious. Looking for what or who has been lost rather than amassing more and more stuff. It's about allowing God to reverse our perspective on life, or to return to my and perhaps Philip's favourite pudding, being turned upside down so we're not just plain stodgy sponges. Tom Wright says that the Beatitudes summon us to live now in the way that will make sense in God's promised future. And he goes on, it may seem upside down, but we are called to believe with great daring that it is in fact the right way up. Try it and see. Well, I'm up for that. Are you? Let's come to stand humble, empty-handed before God, acknowledging that rich as we may or may not be in money, status, or power, we are poor in spirit, utterly dependent on God's astonishing grace and mercy. And as we open our eyes and hold out empty hands, let us both see and receive blessing and rejoice in all God gives. Amen.
Anna has invited us on a journey of response this evening. A journey in which we recognise that too often we are self-sufficient, self-absorbed, self-righteous. And we're invited to come humble, empty-handed before our God, acknowledging that we too are poor in spirit, utterly dependent on God's grace and mercy. People who are invited to turn upside down, be turned upside down by God's amazing love, to see and receive blessing. This song invites us to come to the Father's arms open wide, to the forgiveness bought with the precious blood of Christ, to the Jesus who is calling us to see and receive blessing. So let us come.
Isn't Christ is risen.
And so let us come. Let us come to the loving arms of the Father. Let us come not to be clothed in guilt, but to be covered in blessing. Let us come and walk the path of the poor in spirit, knowing that in that path lies the kingdom of heaven. The sacrifice of God is a broken spirit. A broken and contrite heart God will not despise. Let us come to the Lord, who is full of compassion, and acknowledge our transgressions in penitence and faith. We keep a moment's quiet to prepare as we pray. Together we pray. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you through our own fault, in thought and word and deed, and in what we have left undone. We are heartily sorry and repent of all our sins. For your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Hear these words, knowing God's blessing. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And so, as children of blessing, as children who know what it is to live with Easter joy in the midst of trial, We affirm that truth that is the heart of our Easter faith. Can I invite you, wherever you are, to join with me in standing? And let us declare our faith in the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures. He was buried. He was raised to life on the third day in accordance with the scriptures. Afterwards, he appeared to his followers and to all the apostles. This we have received, and this we believe. Amen. And so, as children of that blessing, we're invited to join our Easter praise. We've gone on a journey recognizing that we are called to be poor in spirit, but that in that place we encounter the loving, merciful, crucified and risen Jesus afresh, and we live under his blessing. And so we praise God, forever he is glorified, forever he is lifted high, forever he is risen, he's alive. Let's go on that journey together.
Defeat.
sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. Lamb is all kind. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. Lamb.
It's been a joy to have you join us in worship here in the chapel tonight. I want to thank Anna for her word to us that I know we will continue to reflect on in the day. In the tech team and all who've taken part in our service this evening. If you want, you can join us on a Zoom social directly after this service. The details are available in the link, and do join and get the chance to say hello to each other at the end of this service. And do join us again next week as we continue our walk through the blessings of the Beatitudes. And we're delighted that Reverend Dr. Liz Kent, who is director of the Wesley Study Centre, will be preaching for us on the Beatitude of Blessed Are Those Who Mourn. And Sam Tranter will be leading us. And so we're looking forward, and you're very welcome to join us again, same time, at same place. But let's go from here, knowing that as poor in spirit, we may also be children of blessing. So let's go in that blessing. May Christ, who out of defeat brings new hope and a new future, fill you with his new life. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you now and forevermore.